Hi, welcome to Eat This, Lose That program. As we mentioned earlier, we are always going to come up with some interesting stories as we go along. And please follow us and like us on Facebook, because every time you're going to find something interesting and you will learn something from the experience. And the point being simple, you have to learn what is lifestyle and diet. You have to change your lifestyle and diet. If you do not learn anything about lifestyle and diet, you are not going to succeed in life when it comes to health. If you're going to expect to deal with medications and feel better taking medications, think again. Having said this, she's a very successful young entrepreneur and a businesswoman, also a highly placed executive in one of the big companies. So she's been working with me regarding her diet and wellness for the last 15 years. And a few months ago, she came in and some of her numbers were abnormal. And she was sitting in the office and looking at the walls, because we have some different pictures and posters on the wall. And she was looking at this picture, was talking about the liver, and she wanted to know more about it. So she asked, "What is this?" And then I said, "It's something to do with liver and FibroScan." She said, "Well, I don't have a problem, but can I get my liver checked?" And that was how many months ago?
So that was about 4 months ago. And just as you said, I was always interested in what you had on your walls. And on seeing the FibroScan, I thought, I wonder if the FibroScan would inform any information about the health of my liver. So we proceeded, didn't we? And I had the FibroScan. And fair to say, I was shocked. I was absolutely shocked.
Because we didn't expect to see stage 2 fibrosis in you for someone who has a great lifestyle and diet, and who also is very particular about exercising every week.
Absolutely, yeah. 25 miles a week runner. If I cycle, it's between 60 and 100 miles.
Excellent.
I don't drink alcohol. I've never smoked. And yeah, this was a real surprise. So
when that happened, we immediately sent you to a gastroenterologist who did further testing. And what did he find?
So, he first of all said, "You're an anomaly because of your lifestyle." But he suggested that we needed to do some further blood tests to validate the FibroScan. And so I waited about 2 weeks for that to come back. And when the results came back, he told me there was good news and not such good news. And the good news was that the blood work didn't validate a stage 2 fibrosis.
Good.
It validated somewhere between a 1 and a 2.
Good.
But the more alarming feedback was that there was a suggestion that I may have had the condition autoimmune hepatitis.
So for viewers, what she's talking about is autoimmune hepatitis, meaning that she probably is developing antibodies against her own liver. And when you start developing antibodies against your liver, they start destroying the liver, which in turn leads to fibrosis and scarring. So when I heard that, I was a little alarmed. Why would someone young like this would have autoimmune hepatitis? And if you do have autoimmune hepatitis, what is the outcome of this? So he said, if you ever develop autoimmune hepatitis, you're looking at 3 to 5 years before you have full cirrhosis and scarring of the liver, needing liver transplant. That was alarming at that point.
That was very alarming. And it was probably the biggest wake-up call that I've had in my 50-plus years of life. And so I had to come to terms with the potential for having to live with a future that required me to be on medication. And I have got this far in life with never requiring
any medication
and being very, very proud of this. And so as I processed this, I felt I needed another validation. So I looked up another specialist in Houston, actually, and then I was also going overseas. And so I arranged to have a further appointment. And interestingly, there was some further blood work carried out. Now, forgive me for not having all the technical definitions of those. And so I waited on these results and was relieved to hear that some of these results indicated I was within normal parameters. But what's most relevant here is the turning point for me upon hearing that a condition like this was perhaps lurking in my body, in my life. And from that day forward, I've introduced fasting. I've introduced a 36-hour fasting from Sunday evening until Tuesday morning. I survive, I thrive on water only, no exceptions. I even manage a workout on the Monday
evening. Do you find
evening.
This hard to do?
I actually find it much easier
okay.
than I ever imagined. People are curious and people are asking me, how do you feel? And what I say to them is, I feel I'm in touch now with my eating habits unlike any time in the past. I feel empowered and excited that I have the willpower to treat my body in this way, like give it a rest and let it recalibrate. And it's the best thing I've ever done. And I think I've enrolled others now in doing something similar.
So to recap, I want to highlight 2 points. Point number one, anytime you come across a situation or a condition and you're at a crossroads and you don't know what's going on and you have been given a diagnosis, do not just trust it, but always get a second opinion. Always get a second opinion. That's what I would always urge. If you're in a situation, you have been given a diagnosis, get a second opinion and confirm it's the right diagnosis. Point number one. Second is, what is the word you said? Empowerment.
Empowered.
If you want to empower yourself to the point where food doesn't affect you and it does not control you, what is the one thing you need to do? Fasting. When you fast, you control food. Food doesn't control you. Unless you understand this, you will never be free. If you are addicted to food and you want to break the chain, you have to fast. Without that, you can never get rid of the addiction.
I'm sure. And, you know, from that 16 weeks ago wake up, you know, I've become heightened. I have a much heightened awareness of what to eat and what not to eat. I do not do sugar. I do no candies now in the office. I might have one treat per week.
Per week.
And I'm very fussy. It's a dark chocolate, maybe a salted caramel. But you know,
aren't we all fascinated with dark chocolate?
But I think it's the sense of control. And for me now, liver health is as important as heart health.
That's the point. It's more important than heart health because if you take care of your liver, everything else falls in place.
Right.
All roads lead to Rome. And where is Rome? That's in your liver.
Yeah.
That means your job is to protect your liver beyond anything else. If you protect your liver, you're helping your brain, you're helping your arteries, you're decreasing inflammation, preventing cancers, you're preventing diabetes,
yeah.
you're protecting yourself against inflammation in arteries and heart disease. So yes,
yeah.
you've come home and you said, liver is number one that I need to take care of.
Liver and heart must live in harmony.
That's correct.
And be well taken care of. And I'm living a normal life. I think that's the other thing.
So what happened to the second opinion? Do you have fibrosis or not? Do you have any scarring at all or not? Do you have any fatty liver or not? Is there a problem? Because you did have a high level of ANA, anti-nuclear antibody.
Yes.
So that tells you that you are at risk for developing rheumatoid arthritis. There is some autoimmune condition lurking in your system.
There is.
And the second question is, one is, why do you have an autoimmune condition? Second is it actually affecting your liver or not?
Right, so great question. So unbeknown to me, when you and I had our appointment 16 weeks ago and when I went to the gastroenterologist, I had forgotten that I had had a positive ANA in the past. I was a 1 in 640.
That's very high.
It is very high. And at that time, because my mother has rheumatoid arthritis, my doctor suggested we have some checks for that. At the time, there was nothing that correlated to me having arthritis. And so in this particular case, the 1 in 640 had shown up again. The second opinion that I had, when that blood work was done, whether it was diet related or not, but my ANA was a 1 in 340.
Good.
So something had shifted.
Because you change your lifestyle and
I
diet.
I think there's a connection there. The one thing that I do know is that I have Hashimoto's, although I do have a thyroid within normal limits.
Right.
And so I am very aware of this whole ANA
So it's
marker.
Interesting. So you have Hashimoto's, but your thyroid is still normal at this point. Your ANA is high, but you change your lifestyle and diet, your ANA levels drop. And I've seen that happen. Patients who have been falling,
okay.
when they change their lifestyle and diet, their ANA levels do drop.
Right.
And so now that means there is something behind the scenes that's lurking.
There's definitely something, and I'm aware of that. And that's why I reinforce the importance of knowing your numbers. And, you know, this is not just knowing your weight. This is knowing, you know, many other numbers, whether they be your cholesterol levels or your liver health and so on. So at this point in time, I am not taking any medication for my liver health.
But the answer to the question, do you have scarring at all or no? So what did the other doctor say?
So I have mild scarring.
So you still have mild scarring.
I have mild scarring, which I would attribute to behaviors leading up to the point that I've now taken a different path.
So he doesn't believe that it is autoimmune hepatitis causing scarring, but there was something else causing scarring of the liver.
That would be correct.
For the viewers, does she have scarring? Yes. Is it moderate, severe, or mild? It is mild.
Correct.
But is it because of autoimmune hepatitis? The second opinion gave her the suggestion that it's probably not because of autoimmune hepatitis, but it could be diet related, it could be sugar, it could be something else she's been doing in the past that probably contributed to this mild scarring, but she's going to now change her lifestyle completely and diet and keep an eye on it and make sure it is not getting worse.
Absolutely. I think key for me now is to ensure that I have regular follow-ups and that from the baseline that we have, we will look for improvements. And if the improvements are there, I will continue with the protocol. If the improvements are not sufficient, then we'll have to go to a more radical step.
Makes sense.
But it's all with the intention, for me at least, to prolong not requiring medication. I do not believe in medication for most conditions because I think we can control what our outcomes are.
Agreed. So that's why I always keep saying that there is no medication or a drug that you can take to prevent, reverse, or manage a condition that actually is caused by eating the wrong food. So the whole concept here is to change your lifestyle and diet. So when you came to us and started working with us, have you ever pushed supplements, nutrients, vitamins, minerals, antioxidants, gimmicks, or asking you to buy something and take it, or ask you to cut your portion sizes or count your calories? We never did any of these.
No, because you believe in it being natural. And that's something I remember from the gastroenterologist discussion. He said to me, if you take protein supplements, if you take vitamins,
they can hurt your liver.
They can hurt your liver.
Correct.
And from that day, I've ceased to entertain any of these protein shakes, protein bars. My supplement intake is now two things. I do vitamin D.
That's correct.
And I do omega
fish oils. That's it.
And that was something you'd recommended a long time
ago. And the three things I recommend is probiotics, vitamin D, and fish oil. But I don't recommend any vitamins, nutrients, minerals. I don't recommend protein powders, protein bars, because I'm seeing a lot of problems with these foods.
Yeah.
So.
And that's an addition to my regime since the experience with FibroScan. And I thank you for that, because
so,
I wouldn't have known otherwise, and then things might have been much, much uglier.
So, for viewers, all this started by just doing a simple FibroScan.
Yeah.
And that's how she found out she was heading the wrong path. And she has now corrected the course and changed her lifestyle and diet. Now, having said this, so for the viewers, what is your recommendation and what would you advise them to do?
We get one life. Our bodies are unique. Just in the same way as we like to manage many other experiences that we have. Take ownership of your health. Get advice from experts, and I highly recommend Dr. Reddy. I've worked with him now for, as we said, about 15, 16 years. But there is something here about taking ownership. Be accountable to yourself. Listen to the advice and watch what changes, both emotionally and physically, within your life.
Well said. So once again, remember, take ownership, and ownership can only happen. Ownership can only happen, A, if you're willing to never complain and never give excuses. B, if you're willing to ask the right, proper questions. Question everything. So if you don't question, you will never learn. If you keep giving excuses, you will never change your lifestyle. So please, no excuses and ask questions. So now that we've come to the end of the session, once again, please go on eatthislosethat.com, look at our different testimonies, follow us on Facebook and Twitter, and ask us questions so we can answer most of your questions through a video format. We also have a newsletter, a video newsletter. Join us, and every 2 weeks we're going to post new, different videos on different topics, and hopefully you learn something from this program. Again, the point is simple. Don't depend on vitamins, nutrients, minerals, antioxidants, supplements, protein bars, protein powders. Focus on eating the natural food, eating the right food, and use a grocery store instead of your pharmacy. Thank you.
Great, Buzz. Thank you very much. Thank you.